Do you have something you're willing to die for? Something that you believe so passionately that you're willing to lay your life down? Not caring how society or others see you, but knowing in your heart that this is your choice. One of my favorite series that has a plethora of these archetypes is Fate. And to be very specific, I'm going to be focusing on characters from Fate Zero and Unlimited Blade's work, because Lord knows how many spin-off entries are in this franchise. But, for those unfamiliar with Fate, here is a speedrun of the basics. In the Fate universe, there are mages who practice magecraft, and hold a to-the-death tournament in order to win the Holy Grail, granting any wish to the victor's desire. To help the mages in their quest to secure the Holy Grail, they each summon a champion called a Servant, from one of seven classes, who has some regret in life that would attract them to said magical cup, with the classes being Caster, Assassin, Rider, Berserker, Lancer, Archer, and finally the Waifu class, lesser known as the Saber class, with the last mage standing being able to obtain the Holy Grail. Yes, I know, I skimmed over a lot, but don't worry about it. If you do want a better dive, I left a video of Giguk in the description that you can check out after this video. And after you like, comment, and subscribe. Okay, I'm sorry. But the characters I want to focus on in this video is Saber, Kiritsugu, and lastly, one other who challenges their viewpoints. It's crazy how the moment that creates the path for a hero can be so different. Like, let's compare Kiritsugu with one of my favorite heroes, Spider-Man. We all by now should know the origin story of Spider-Man. Hell, we've had more than three origins in the past decade. But I will say it once again, Peter Parker was a normal high school nerd, he got bullied, yada yada, school field trip, gets bit by radioactive spider, yada yada yada. And then, the moment that makes Spider-Man, Spider-Man, the death of Uncle Ben. For Peter, this is the start of his life as a hero. Not the gaining of powers, but the moment he realizes what Uncle Ben's words of, with great power, there must also come great responsibility, meaning now to him as a person who has had these abilities imposed upon him. But the way in which Peter realizes this is vastly different than Kiritsugu. Peter had Uncle Ben taken away from him by the actions of a criminal, with that driving him to becoming a hero. Whereas for Kiritsugu, his origin doesn't have that luxury of being a victim. Kiritsugu started out as a normal kid on an island, doing what most would do, be in their village and exploring the surrounding areas, playing to his heart's content. But the thing that made him different from the island's folk was his father being a mage and practicing magecraft. Most of the town folks were hesitant about Kiritsugu's father, except for a girl named Shirley, who befriended the family and was studying under his father, learning how to freeze time in organic objects, with Shirley wanting to share this gift with the world to help others. But this sadly is the Fate universe, and no matter how good of intentions someone may have, it usually ends in tragedy, as one morning Kiritsugu was barred from entering town that day for an unknown reason by his dad. As the day's hours passed, it seemed odd when Shirley didn't arrive like usual. So, Kiritsugu, disregarding his father's words, he went out and searched for her in the village. After searching town, he eventually found her at home, mangling a chicken, accursed with something from an unknown vial, slowly turning her into a blood-seeking savage. In her last few moments of sanity, she begged for Kiritsugu to end her life. This was the moment of Kiritsugu's life that brought upon him becoming a hero. You would immediately assume that from my sentence, he killed Shirley and saved the townsfolk. When, in reality, he let her go, not being able to bring himself to execute Shirley. The result of which was the whole town turning, leading to the death of the whole island, with them needing to be exterminated. Kiritsugu didn't become a hero because something was taken from him. The road began because he wouldn't do what was needed and take from another to save the masses. Kiritsugu finds that his father was the crux of this whole outbreak, as he was the person responsible for the serum, calling this case a failure, and seeking a way to replicate it without the negative effects, regardless of the amount of times it fails. The moment Kiritsugu discovered the truth, he took his first steps down the road of him becoming a tragic hero, and takes his father's life without a single ounce of hesitation. He learned from his mistake with Shirley and vowed to exterminate the world of the same people like his father and to save the masses, ultimately becoming a mercenary. It's honorable to want to become a hero of the world and save as many as you can, but when your ideal is all you cling to, you become like Saber, a slave to it. This Saber is King Arthur from British Legends, the one we all know, pulling the sword out of the stone, having the Knights of the Round Table, and receiving Excalibur from the Lady of the Lake. With the regret that has Saber beckoning the call of the Grail, being how the kingdom she ruled laid in tattered ruins towards the end of her reign, and wishing that she never pulled out. The ideals of a king in Saber's mind was one who was separate from the regular people, and is to be a servant to their subjects, never being afraid to lead her army from the front lines and ruling her kingdom as fair as she was capable, not letting emotions deviate her decrees. There's nothing wrong with being a selfless king and wanting to do right by your people, but Saber does it to the point of being a martyr, placing the blame solely on herself, seeing that no sacrifice is too big in order to ensure prosperity for her country. So then you may be wondering, who was the character I believe challenges those two ideals? Well, for that, we have to go to Fate Zero sequel. Well, more accurately, predecessor, since it was released first but is later on the timeline. Basically, it pulls a Star Wars. Okay, now spoilers for the Unlimited Bladeswork route of Fate Stay Night. And if you don't know what that means... Okay, I will make this quick. This is Fate Stay Night, a visual novel, and within it is three different routes. The Saber route, the Unlimited Bladeswork route, and the Heavenfields route. To put it into anime terms, Saber's route is Neon Genesis Evangelion, the TV series, Unlimited Bladeswork is the end of Evangelion, and Heavenfield is just like the Rebuild series, having no damn idea what is going on, but by the end of it, you have no idea what the hell just happened, but somehow it is still connected to the same universe as the other two. Got it? Good. Shiro is a person known to help anyone he can. As in his first scenes, we see him helping the student council president with repairs to classrooms, out of just sheer generosity. But he's like this to a fault, as a fellow classmate Shinji, more like a shit stain, thrusts his responsibility of cleaning the archery dojo onto Shiro, after Shiro accused Shinji of being the cause for a fellow student to miss school. The result of which, Shiro stayed late into the night at school, and unfortunately becomes a victim of the Holy Grail War, with him being killed by the Lancer-class servant. As he's bleeding out and his body senses fading, a figure comes into view with their words echoing, "Why did it have to be you?" as Shiro dies. So you may be thinking, okay, is our main character just dead now? Well, the answer is not for long, as Shiro wakes with his injuries healed and an unknown gem by his side, and heads home, to which Lancer shows up again attempting to kill him, and which, after doing his best to hold his own, Shiro is cornered in his back home and unknowingly summons a waifu, and causes Lancer to retreat, leaving Shiro now as a participant of the Holy Grail War. But the two aren't given a moment's rest as the archer class servant and the best girl arrives. So you may be assuming Shiro is a person who contradicts their ideals, right? Well, yes, and no. I will say once again, spoilers for Unlimited Bladeswork's big reveal, so if you want to watch the series first, please do so now. Okay, everybody's had ample time to leave. I don't want another comment like this to happen, because I would actually feel really bad because this series is amazing. Let me just say, the foreshadowing throughout Unlimited Bladeswork to the reveal of Shiro being Archer was so elegantly crafted that it makes sense on rewatch. But for those of higher storytelling IQ, it can be seen on the first watch through, before the series just straight up tells us. Archer despises his younger self to the point that he wants him to die, either by Shiro killing himself or Archer killing him. Which is still killing himself. Man, this takes handing yourself to a paradoxical level. In my opinion, the fuel behind all the hatred is because Archer is the culmination of Kiritsugu and Saber combined. A man who wanted to be a champion of justice, and in doing so became a senseless killer, wanting to rid the world of those who would cause harm. But as well, being a hero full of regret from the moment his wish to live out such ideal was granted, becoming a slave forced to execute every command his ideal issued. Shiro and Archer are two sides of the same coin, both points just as valuable as the other, but never able to see eye to eye, with the determining factor for whichever one has worth being decided with which side to land upon. For Archer, he wishes not to become a guardian, this person reeking with the smell of death and dismay everywhere he goes. And for what? Just to be sent out again, smearing himself even further with the blood of countless, faceless targets, all for the chance to have a world where no one would cry? With Archer reaching the same conclusion as Kiritsugu, it's impossible to save everyone, as even sacrificing the few to save the many still means damning those to misery. And eventually, the scales will tip out of balance, like the Grail said. It's a hypocritical idea. A true hero of justice can never save everyone. As to fight for something, there has to be an opposing force, and those who do not align with you cannot hope to be saved. And who says that those who were saved will be appreciative, as Archer reveals the sad truth of his demise? That of being betrayed and sent to the noose. But he has no peace, as a guardian is taken out of the cycle of death and rebirth, with it just becoming a living hell in purgatory for Archer. Shiro hears all of this from his future self, a person who should know him better than any other, and tells Archer he's wrong. Shiro stands boldly and doubles down on his pursuit of becoming a champion of justice, stating that he and Archer are two different people. Which is kind of ironic. And so with the two being at their wits' end, they settle their ideological differences like gentlemen, trying to kill each other. Okay, quick side tangent. What is it about us as men and suddenly our problems having some aspect of either death or bodily harm? Because I just found out about a duel from 1808 where the two guys were dueling with shotguns while in hot air balloons. Yeah, crazy. Okay, I'm sorry, I'll curb my ADHD. Now back to the fight that probably cost the same as a small nation's GDP. Archer and Shiro enter into a reality marble, and here our fight takes on another layer, not just of Archer trying to kill Shiro physically, but to also murder his resolve to following his ideals, with Archer saying the moment that began them both down this path was the end of the previous Holy Grail War, when the city was in ruins with them being lost and hopeless in this whirlwind of just death, and having a miracle of Kiritsugu finding them in the rubble. With them admiring him and inheriting his dream and placing that as the root of who they were. Every decision was passed through their hypocritical idea. Every emotion was removed to fulfill such. All of themselves was thrown to the wayside so that their ideal would reign supreme. Archer showed Shiro the hell he was walking into if he decided to pursue the path set before him. But Archer forgot one thing. That this road isn't the first time Shiro has walked through hell. Shiro saying that he has already been through hell is a valid point, because surviving the previous Holy Grail War and the haunting reality of what it brought. Just imagine being in a world where all your eyes can see are columns of flame, no matter which end of the horizon your eyes gaze upon. With the air being weighed down with the scent of human corpses, echoing the sounds of those who were soon to be. Marching through it all, knowing you are powerless to change this world where so many were forced to call their final resting place, while you were spared, given the freedom to escape. With them admiring the man who gave that freedom and his wish to save others. With Shiro choosing to inherit the wish no matter the cost, with no regrets. Understanding that it is a sham and foolish, he still chooses to stand by it. and in a beautiful scene, Shiro pulls a sword from the ground, mirroring Saber. And this being his crossing the Rubicon moment, cementing his first steps down the road to hell. But this time, with a spirit whose passion burns hotter than the flames that would encompass him. The two battle now no longer on killing physically, but seeing whose spirit would be broken by the other, with Shiro being the one who reigns the victor in this battle of wills. Fate as a series has a healthy range of characters and ideals that, when two opposing views collide, it's an interesting thing for the audience, as sometimes it isn't as black and white with who was right and who was wrong, but instead letting us decide who's to give value. So now I ask you, whose side of the coin do you choose to face?